Okay, so let us quickly start recollecting what we did yesterday. Can anyone summarize what we did yesterday in agriculture?
So types of crops depending upon the season, that is rabi crop, kharif crop and kharif crop.
Yeah, very good. And after we learnt about
some common crops grown in India.
Not common crops, not the common crops, the major crops. Yeah, major crops. We started learning about a few of the major crops.
Sir, plantations.
Plantations, yes, we started off with plantations. Then we learned about Kharif, Rabi and Zaid crops. And then we started learning about the major crops
millets.
Which grow in India. We learned about millets, we learned about maize, rice, wheat. And then continuing forward, let us see what and all crops we have now to learn about. We have only 50% of the students who join this online class. I wonder what happens to the other 50%. Good morning, Paras. Okay, anyway, let us not delay any further. We'll start. So we had stopped yesterday at maize, right? So let us continue and see what the next crop we have to learn about. We have pulses. Yes. Now, pulses are mainly all your dals. Whatever dal you use at home, there are varieties of dals. We have tur dal, moong dal. We have masoor dal. We have urad dal. Then we have chana dal. So many varieties of dal are there, and each and every dal, you know, they serve a different purpose. They serve, they, you know, make us different kinds of dishes. It's used, and mainly for vegetarians. As far as vegetarians are concerned, the dal is the main source of protein for vegetarians. So, because other vegetables and all that would not give you that much of proteins, but the dals and pulses provide us vegetarians with the main source of protein. So India is the largest producer as well as consumer of pulses in the entire world. There are major, these are a major source of protein in a vegetarian diet. Major pulses grown in India, these are tur dal, also called as arhar dal, urad dal, moong dal, masoor, peas and gram. So these are the major pulses which are grown in India. Pulses need less moisture and survive even in dry conditions. That is why most of the plateau regions in India, they grow these pulses. So, if you see the crop producing states, you would see that they are either located on some plateau or the other, where the conditions are normally dry because pulses don't need much of moisture. All these crops except arhar help in restoring soil fertility by fixing nitrogen from the air, because of which it is grown in rotation with other crops. You would have learnt about nitrogen fixation in your science. Correct, na? So what happens is most of the other crops, they absorb nitrogen, because nitrogen is something which is present in majority in our air, maximum amount, right? So the consumption of nitrogen is maximum by other crops. What these pulse crops do is they help in fixing the nitrogen into the soil. They absorb the nitrogen and they fix it into the soil. You would also heard of them as, you know, being legumes. In your science, mostly
yes,
they would have been referred to as legumes. These are the same pulses, same things. Except for tur dal, all other pulses, they do this function of fixing nitrogen in the soil, and that's the reason why once one major crop is grown, the next rotation crop normally they will plant one of these pulses so that the soil restores its nitrogen quantity, and then again another kind of crop in a rotation pattern the planting will be done. Major pulse producing states in India are Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, Maharashtra and Karnataka. These are the major pulse growing states in India. Okay, next, my favorite, sugarcane. It is a tropical as well as subtropical crop. So sugarcane has that quality that it grows only in tropical and subtropical climates. You will not find sugarcane growing in other kinds of climates. It grows well in hot and humid climate with a temperature of 21 to 27 degrees Celsius and an annual rainfall of between 75 to 100 centimeters. So rainfall is extremely required for this crop, plus heat is also required for the crop. So the ideal hot and wet climate you will find in tropical and subtropical areas where this crop is grown. Can be grown on a variety of soils and needs manual labor from sowing to harvesting. If any of you in your families have sugarcane fields, either your somebody in your relatives or you yourself might be having, your grandparents might be having, you would have seen that it requires a lot of manual labor right from the planting time till the harvesting time. So this is a very labor intensive crop, but the price which is received after sale of this also is very high. So it is a very lucrative business for planting sugarcane. India is the second largest producer just after Brazil, and main source of sugar, jaggery, khandasari and molasses. So these are the main outputs from sugar, from sugarcane. Major sugar producing states are Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Bihar, Punjab and Haryana. So everybody is clear with pulses and sugarcane. Anybody has any doubts?
No, sir.
No, sir.
What is this khandasari which is written over there? Main source of sugar, jaggery, khandasari and molasses. Can anyone tell me what khandasari is? Since nobody has any doubts. Nobody knows?
No, sir.
Then how come nobody asked me this doubt, sir? What is this khandasari? I don't know.
Sir, raw mine sugar.
Correct. I don't know. In Kannada, we call it as kalsakkare. Those are big lumps of sugar. Normally, you will find it during Sankranti time. It is like, big lumps of white sugar. That is called as khandasari. Yes. Kalsakkare also, we call it in Kannada. So, that is sugarcane. Next, we have tea. Yeah, come again, ma? Someone said something? Correct. Yeah. Okay. So tea. Next crop we are going to study about is tea. This is a fine example of a plantation crop. Important brewing crop introduced in India by the British. Tea plantation grows well in tropical and subtropical climates, endowed with deep and fertile, well-drained soil, rich in humus and organic matter. Tea bushes require warm and moist climate free throughout the year. So it requires a warm climate, but it should be moisture free. So it requires a dry type of climate. Tea requires abundant, cheap and skilled labor. You would have seen in all the tea advertisements, people picking up these tender tea leaves and putting it in their basket. So a lot of labor is required in the tea industry. Tea is processed within the tea garden to restore its freshness. Major tree producing states are Assam, hills of Darjeeling and Jalgaipuri districts in that, I think that would be in Assam, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. These are the, normally you would see tea being grown in the northern parts of India. India is the leading producer as well as exporter of tea in the world. In fact, Assam tea, Darjeeling tea, all these have a very huge market in the European countries.
Sir, China is not the first.
China may be, but it is not the, I don't hear it say, it says over here it's the leading producer as well as exporter. But let us check out about China. Maybe not as far as tea, they do consume tea, yes. China do consume a lot of tea, but maybe they don't produce it in as much quantity as we do.
Second is China.
Second would be China, yeah. So at least something.
Sir, it was first.
It was first. Did we overtake it or something? Or?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. No, we'll check it out. I will cross check this information and see whether, you know, maybe China is the largest, we are the second. We'll see. Okay, I'll check it out. Okay, so next we have coffee, again another favorite of mine. India produces about 4% of the world's coffee. Indian coffee is known in the world for its good quality. The Arabica variety, initially brought from Yemen, is produced in India. This is the variety of coffee which is grown in India, and it has this distinctive flavor. There are many varieties of coffee which are grown all over different parts of the world. And the Arabica variety has a very distinct flavor. There are again many countries in South America also which have their different types of coffees grown. In African countries also different types are there. So wherever the coffee is grown, they have their distinct flavor over there. The variety is of great demand in the world. The Arabica variety is of the largest demand in the entire world because of the distinct, it has a slight bitterish sweet flavor which it has. Its cultivation was initially introduced on the Baba Budan Hills, and even today its cultivation is confined to the Nilgiri in Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. So here we have only the southern states as compared to tea which is grown in the northern states. Here we have in the southern states where coffee is grown. If any time you do get an opportunity to travel to Chikmagalur and the Nilgiri hills over there, beautiful means beautiful coffee plantations are over there. You know, the amount of greenery which you can see, you know, it is very, very eye pleasing. So if you do get an opportunity anytime, please travel there with your family. That was coffee. So now we will come to the horticulture crops. India is the largest producer of fruits and vegetables in the world. India is producer of tropical as well as temperate fruits. So horticulture crops mainly means the fruits and vegetables which are grown, and India is one of the largest producers of fruits and vegetables in the entire world. So you know, this attaining this position from a position where just after independence we used to import most of our foods and food grains and vegetables, we are now in a position where we are producing the largest quantity in the entire world. Fruit in great demand, mangoes of Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal. These are most popular fruits. Incidentally, very recently we have concluded with the mango season. Still you will find a few mangoes, varieties of mangoes available in the market. Oranges of Nagpur and Chirapunji. Bananas of Kerala, Mizoram, Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. Lychee and guava of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. Pineapples of Meghalaya. Grapes of Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra, apples, pears, apricots and walnuts of Jammu and Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh. These are all the, you know, each and every state is famous for a certain fruit, and these are the list of those states where these fruits are famous. India produces 13% of the world's vegetables. That is a big number. It is an important producer of pea, cauliflower, onion, cabbage, tomato, brinjal and potato. And India accounts for 10% of the world's fruit production. Yeah. So after horticulture crops, next we have rubber. This is an industrial crop. It is...
Non-food crop.
Non-food crop, correct. It is an equatorial crop which... But under special conditions, it is also grown in tropical and subtropical areas. Requires moist and humid climate with rainfall of more than 200 centimeters and temperature about 25 degrees Celsius. So a typical tropical kind of climate it requires for growing rubber trees. It is an important industrial raw material. It is mainly grown in Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Garo Hills of Meghalaya. India ranks fifth among the world's natural rubber producers. Okay, so where and all this natural rubber is being used, majority of it goes for the auto tires and tubes industry. Then it goes for cycle tires and tubes industry. It goes for camelback, that is for a type of footwear. Footwear's industry, belts and hoses, latex, foam, dipped goods, others. So a lot of industries is where rubber is being used. In fact, you will find in a some or the other household item that rubber is there. So after the rubber crop, let us come to the next non-food crop, that is fiber crops. Cotton, jute, hemp and natural silk are the four major fiber crops grown in India. The first three are derived. Yeah, come again.
So what is hemp?
Cotton, jute and hemp. Hemp is very similar to jute. I will just check, okay? Okay, hemp is basically, it is also called as cannabis, and it is used for industrial use in the medicinal industry. So that is hemp. It is a variety of cannabis.
Okay.
So the first three are derived from crops grown in the soil. Silk is obtained from cocoons of silkworms fed on green leaves, especially mulberry. This you have already learnt, I think in your 600 ML you would have learnt how silk is produced. Rearing of silkworms for the production of silk fiber is known as sericulture. Cotton. Cotton is believed to be the original home of cotton plant. India is believed to be known as the original home of cotton plant. One of the main raw materials of cotton textile industry, India is the third largest producer of cotton in the world. Cotton grows well in drier parts of black soil of Deccan Plateau. So requirement for cotton is dry black soil, requires high temperature, light rainfall, 210 frost-free days and bright sunshine for growth. It's a kharif crop which requires 8 to 10 months to mature. Maharashtra, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Haryana, Punjab, Tamil Nadu and Uttar Pradesh are major cotton producing states. So we can see that many of the states are involved in the production of cotton. Okay, so this was all about the major crops of India. Does anybody have any doubt till now? Is everything clear?
Yes, sir, it's clear.
Okay. Okay, so next we will come to see the technological reforms which are happening in the agriculture industry. What is the problem? Why are students joining so late? Shreyas, Rasika. Now don't tell me I've been trying till 8, since 8:50 only, since Till almost 9 o'clock, I have been letting children inside. Okay, technological and institutional reforms in the agriculture industry. Agriculture has been practiced in India for thousands of years. Sustained uses of land without compatible techno-institutional changes have hindered the pace of agricultural development. So even though India is an agriculture country, for many years, the type of produce we are supposed to get from agriculture has not been happening. That is the reason why, even though we are an agriculture country, we had almost 70% of the population involved in agriculture. Still then, the produce coming out from agriculture was not sufficient. That is the main reason why we need a lot of technological and institutional reforms to improve the yield from agriculture. Why has India not improved in technical and institutional reforms in agriculture? In spite of development of sources of irrigation, most of the farmers in large parts of the country still depend upon monsoon and natural fertility in order to carry on their agriculture. So the dependency of monsoon in our country is very, very high. We would have heard of news wherever there is a failure in the monsoon, it leads to crop destruction. Whenever there is excess of monsoon, that also leads to crop destruction. So the dependency on monsoon is extremely high. Rather than having fully irrigated lands, which will reduce this dependency on monsoon, still the dependency on natural monsoon climate is again very high. Agriculture needs serious technical and institutional reforms. Collectivization, consolidation of holdings, cooperation and abolition of zamindari, etc. were given priority to bring reforms in the country after independence. Land focus was the main focus of the first five-year plan. Right of inheritance had led to fragmentation of land holdings. Right of inheritance means, now if there is a farmer who has five or six children, sons, and he is having a huge holding of land. As per the right of inheritance, this land would get equally divided among all the children.
Your voice is cracking.
Is my voice breaking, students, other students?
Sir, it's clear.
Okay. So, as I was saying, the right of inheritance, what happens is, whenever there is a big piece of land owned by a farmer and he has maybe five or six children, on the death of that farmer, this piece of land would get divided to five or six different people. And so on, again the division would happen on their deaths when it's getting transferred to their children. So, this right of inheritance is what is leading to the fragmentation of land holdings, means smaller and smaller pieces of land. And if there is smaller and smaller pieces of land, it means that the scope to do agriculture on a large scale is further reduced, because many times what happens is people are not able to continue with their farming activities. They stop the farming activities, they come to the city side in search of other employment, and many times also these farmlands are sold for construction of houses. So many things are there which are creating a problem for the advancement of agriculture. Laws of land reforms were enacted, but laws of implementation were lacking. What were the steps taken by government in agricultural reforms? Government of India embarked upon introducing agricultural reforms to improve Indian agriculture during the 1960s and 70s. The Green Revolution also was a very large part of this. Green Revolution, based on the use of package technology, and White Revolution, Operation Flood, that was for the maximizing of the produce of milk, were some of the strategies initiated to improve Indian agriculture. But this led to the concentration of development in few selected areas. Therefore, in the 1980s and 1990s, a comprehensive land development program was initiated, which included both institutional and technical reforms. When we talk about institutional reforms, it means the Department of Agriculture getting down and creating certain institutions which is going to help the farmers. Technical reforms means that the implementation of modern agricultural methods. These are technical reforms. Provision for crop insurance against calamities, establishment of Grameen banks, cooperative societies and bank for providing loan facilities to the farmer at low interest rates are some of the steps taken. And all these also come under the institutional reforms. So a lot of reforms, it is not only getting the maximum yield from the land. It involves a lot of support to the farmer, that farmer's crop needs to be insured against calamities. The farmer would require loans so that he has easy access to capital for cultivation. All these kinds of reforms have to come together, and only then we can see a true green revolution. And since there has been so much effort by the governments, you know, to increase the, to support the farmer, that is the reason why we are in such a position today that, you know, we are the largest producer of fruits and vegetables. We are in a position to export milk also. Operation Flood, a very, very successful operation in India. If any of you, if you have the time, please read the story of Amul, one of the biggest success stories in the entire world in the cooperative sector for milk. How the cooperatives were formed and how they were able to bring in together so many milk farmers and become one of the most successful organizations in the world, wherein today they are capable of exporting milk. So please do read that story of Amul if you are if you do get the time. If anyone reads it, we can discuss about it tomorrow. So that's all for now. Today we learned about a few other major crops, and then after that we learned about the non-food crops like rubber and the fiber crops, and then we also learned about the institutional and technical reforms which are happening in the agricultural sector in India today. So that's all for now. We will again join back again together tomorrow. Please do join at 1:30. There is a meeting, online meeting with the principal and students of 10th standards. All the students compulsorily have to join. Join with the cameras on. The link will be posted again in the lecture section. So that's all for now. Take care. Bye-bye.